Okay, well, I want to be respectful of our time, and it is just after 11 o'clock. My name is Peter Dolkart. I'm a community development manager with the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond, and I want to thank you for joining us today. And again, I will come out and say I apologize. There was some confusion as to the time. I'll take responsibility. We initially had a website that posted this time at 10 a.m. and thankfully people alerted me to it, and I thank you for making it on the appropriate time. So sorry about that confusion. I work with a team of community development folks at the Richmond Fed. I'm joined by my colleague Erica Bell, who is my counterpart in North and South Carolina. And we also have another colleague, Tiffany Holland Wright, who works in Virginia and West Virginia. This is an exciting program for us. We've been doing Investment Connection for now a couple of years in the Richmond Fed District, the 5th District. But what's exciting about this is really, I think, the first time we've done it across the entire district in one application round. And we're also doing it focused on a very specific sector and type of community, which is rural communities and so on. So again, just a couple of reminders, logistics. One is we do ask you to stay on mute until there's an opportunity to ask questions. We ask you to use the chat feature to let us know if you do have a question, and optimally even to put your question there and so on. And with that, hopefully you're seeing my slide deck and we're gonna get started. So I have a set group of slides that I will walk you through the role of the Community Reinvestment Act and the role of Investment Connection, and then some guidelines. And guidelines and best practices for Investment Connection. And then we also do want to cover what do we mean by rural, or what do you mean when we talk about rural, and so on. So allow me to just kind of run through these slides. There's a bit of them, and then we can open it up to questions. So let's get started. First thing first, the views expressed here are the presenters, which is me, and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond or the Federal Reserve System.
See what we can do, Frank. You'll be the last one getting off.
Excuse me, I think somebody needs to go on mute, if they can, please. Thanks. Okay, so when we're talking about Investment Connection, we really have to start by talking about what is the CRA, what is the Community Reinvestment Act? That is really the guiding principle and purpose for Investment Connection. And it really guides why we have a community development department at the Federal Reserve Banks. So the Community Reinvestment Act, or CRA, was legislation that was passed by Congress in 1977. And what it does is it encourages banks to provide credit needs, to give access to credit to communities, the entire community, where they are taking deposits. So it means that they have to include providing access to borrowers of all different levels of income, both businesses and small farms of different sizes. They have to include low and moderate income neighborhoods, also both distressed or underserved communities, both in urban areas, but also in rural areas, and also even disaster areas. Now, one thing I want to emphasize is that while they are supposed to be and encouraged to provide loans and access to credit and other banking services to all communities, they need to do it in a consistently safe and sound operation. So CRA is not asking them to do any undue risks or take on any unwise banking practices. They need to do it in a consistent and safe and sound operation. So where does CRA come from? Well, we all have heard the term redlining. It comes from a period of time in the early 20s, in the 1930s and beyond, where banks essentially were not lending to certain regions, certain communities, often on racial lines, ethnic lines, and also on income. That was both in urban areas and in rural areas as well. And we're still living with the legacy of that practice. So the Community Reinvestment Act was created in 1977 as a result of a package of anti-discriminatory laws. We had the Fair Housing Act of 1968, the Equal Credit Opportunity Act of 1974, and the Home Mortgage Disclosure Act of 1975. We often call that HMDA. And the Community Reinvestment Act came along in 1977. So there are three federal bank agencies, the federal regulatory agencies that are tasked with enforcing the Community Reinvestment Act. And again, what they do is they assess a bank's performance in the communities that they are taking deposits. They have to ensure that they are in fact serving those communities. They're providing access to loans, to home mortgages, to banking services, and so on, and doing so in a safe and sound manner. And the three agencies that are tasked with doing that on the federal level are the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, better known as the FDIC, the Federal Reserve System, of which the Richmond Fed is part of that, and the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency. So the Federal Reserve System, that's what I work for. So the Federal Reserve System, a lot of people, when they think of the Fed or the Federal Reserve, they think of the Board of Governors in Washington, who essentially are a federal agency. But the Federal Reserve System is actually a broader, is made up of 12 districts across the United States. Each district is headquartered with a Federal Reserve Bank. And the role of the Federal Reserve is promoting stable prices, employment, and moderate interest rates. Most people know that through our monetary policy, something known as the Federal Open Market Committee. It's also to provide a safe and sound financial system so that when you use an ATM machine or you transfer money through an electric wire transfer, that system works and you can depend on it. And then also by connecting with community stakeholders for economic conditions. Now, I would rather to use the word community development, but I didn't make the slide, so I have to stick with the word economic conditions. So we are in the Richmond Fed District, the fifth district, and that covers South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia, the District of Columbia is kind of tucked in here, Maryland, and most of West Virginia, except that upper panhandle. So the folks on this call who are participating should hopefully come from those particular states and jurisdictions. So what does the Community Reinvestment Act target? The community investment, well, we love to use the term LMI. Let's say what that is. That is low and moderate income. And we tend to use the Community Reinvestment Act to think of it as people, places, small businesses, and farms. So in the case of businesses and people, the Community Reinvestment Act makes sure that banks and financial institutions are serving people of low and moderate income. And I'll explain what that means in a moment. Small businesses earning less than $1 million in revenue. That's our definition for small business. Also small farms. I think small farms is actually closer to $500,000 in revenue. And then also places, communities that also have large portions of low and moderate income individuals, distressed or blighted communities, both in cities and suburbs and rural areas. Regions that are already being targeted for redevelopment, and then disaster areas. Now, when the Community Reinvestment Act was passed in 1977, I think they thought of a disaster area as primarily a weather-related incident or a climate-related incident. But as the last 18 months, we've experienced a type of different disaster, and COVID is actually considered part of that designation of disaster area. And I'll talk about that in a second. So let's get to the heart of what we're talking about, low and moderate income. We're talking about either individuals or households and communities that are essentially either making 80% or less of what is the area median income for their community. And how do we find out where the area median income is? Well, that's through the census tract, through census tract information and other types of information. But that's who we're talking about. So when we say LMI, we're saying that target point of 80% or less in terms of income. I did provide for you the other kind of income levels just so you can see where all that fits in, middle income and upper income. But we're focused for the purposes of investment connection and the Community Reinvestment Act on low and moderate income, households, individuals, communities. So what activities? Well, this is not a comprehensive list, but in terms of the activities that qualify under the Community Reinvestment Act, in terms of various buckets, we're talking about affordable housing for low and moderate income individuals. workforce development in terms of training programs, job skill programs, employment assistance programs, again, for low and moderate income individuals. There's a lot of job training programs out there that assist people with switching careers or changing their skills, but they don't necessarily are exclusive or primarily focused on low and moderate income individuals. When we're talking about investment connection and the Community Reinvestment Act, that primary focus has to be LMI. Community service and facilities, that could be Head Start centers, libraries, community centers, and so on, as long as they're primarily serving low and moderate income individuals. Not exclusively, though. You don't have to exclusively serve that population, but that has to be the primary focus. Promote economic development, that again creates and retains permanent jobs, small business financing, farms as well. And again, stabilizing distressed or blighted areas. Broadband access, which has become a big issue, of course, in the pandemic. It should have always been a big issue, but the pandemic has made it even more of an issue. That is also covered under the Community Reinvestment Act as an improved activity. Energy efficiency. And then again, disaster relief. I just did see somebody ask, what about emergency repairs for residential housing? Yes, if it is in fact housing for low and moderate income individuals, yes. When we talk about COVID, you'll see that covered. But yes, that does cover. There are programs in the Baltimore metropolitan area that specifically assist people with doing repairs, and they do cover under the Community Reinvestment Act. Now, some programs are also only targeted to senior citizens, which is a very valuable program, but not all senior citizens are low and moderate income. So that's the distinction, and so on. So I did mention COVID. So in March of last year, the three regulators, FDIC, OCC, and the Federal Reserve System issued a joint statement emphasizing that they would put a priority on certain investments and activity by banks that specifically help people with COVID in terms of Community Reinvestment Act activity. And so on. As far as I know, that hasn't changed. Now, that doesn't mean that other activities not related to COVID that fall under the Community Reinvestment Act are not still important. They are. They simply wanted to make it clear to banks over the last 18 months that if they were redirecting their priorities towards assisting people with COVID-related issues, that would also be covered under the Community Reinvestment Act. And that would be sustaining small business operations, supporting food supply and service provisions, healthcare access, broadband. Just to follow up on a question I just got, no, the repairs to households don't have to be under an emergency situation. They can be just generally helping people in low and moderate income repair their homes and maintain their residences, and so on. Okay, moving on to what are we talking about in terms of money? In terms of investing, when we're talking about what type of investment, they really fall under three different categories for the Community Reinvestment Act. Loans, mortgage loans, small business loans, and community development assistance loans, you name it, as long as it's helping a project or initiative that is in fact serving low and moderate income communities. Qualified investments is really a complicated way of saying grants, okay? Just direct payment, direct investment without any expectation of the financial institution being paid back. And then community development services, which is basically when a bank or financial institution provides some type of assistance that's not monetary. And that could be literally providing technical assistance, serving on a board of a community development organization, providing HR or resources, providing equipment, providing office space, something that wouldn't normally fall under a monetary monetary issue. I got a question just now about, well, what happens if a bank doesn't comply with the Community Reinvestment Act? Great question. We say encourage, but here's the reality. If a bank does not, in a CRA exam, get a minimum of a satisfactory rating, they will not be able to expand. They will not be able to open up new branches. They will not be able to merge. Until they can prove they have a satisfactory rating. That's the stick in the Community Reinvestment Act when it comes to the fact that if they don't maintain a satisfactory rating, optimally they want an outstanding rating, but if they don't get a satisfactory rating, they're not going to be able to open up another branch, expand the bank's reach, and so on until they can prove that they have that rating. So let me give you a few examples, and they're just a few examples of the Community Investment Act activities. I mentioned on the service side, a bank can provide technical assistance through their employees. They can even provide equipment. They can provide serve on the board of a nonprofit organization that's serving low and moderate income communities. Then, of course, there is the grant side of things. They can literally put money into what is known as a community development finance institution. These are lending organizations specifically set up to serve low and moderate income communities. And they can also put into affordable housing projects and agencies. They can help with low income housing tax credits. And they can do other types of direct payment. And then of course there's loans and affordable housing, nonprofit assistance, facilities helping finance nonprofit assistance. And so on. These are just a few examples of what banks can do in terms of providing funding and so on. Federal credit unions are not covered under the Community Reinvestment Act, at least when it was set up in 1977. So only banks and thrifts, depository institutions and thrifts, are covered by the Community Reinvestment Act. Now, I will tell you that for Investment Connection, we don't limit our focus to banks. Anybody who can fund, any funder, a foundation, a philanthropy, a government agency, a university, and a credit union, if their money is green, they're welcome to the table. Let's talk about Investment Connection, okay? And so on. So I think I went backwards, I apologize. Okay, so Investment Connection at its heart is basically almost like a dating service, almost a matchmaking service between nonprofits, small businesses, and community organizations who have projects that serve the needs of low and moderate income communities. And what we're here to do is an introductory service between them and financial institutions, foundations, and grant makers, and so on. So of course, those organizations are free at any time to go one by one to all of those institutions on their own, bank to bank, foundation to foundation. We're just trying to provide a one-stop efficient way of letting a large group of those organizations, those institutions know about your proposal in one specific platform and way of marketing. But a couple caveats. We, the Fed, do not provide direct funding, nor do we have some type of specific fund of or pool of banks and institutions. We do our best to try to market Investment Connection so that they are part of the funders portal and that they also attend our pitch session, but we don't provide direct funding. And then let's set expectations. There is no guarantee that you're going to get funding by participating in Investment Connection. And I will say that over the 2 years we've done it, it is a developing process. It can take several months, if not years, between an organization putting in a proposal on Investment Connection and then finally getting interest or support. So I don't want you to think that if you are part of Investment Connection, that their funding is just around the corner. I wish it was the case. We're gonna work with you to find a way that make that happen the best we can. But the reality is that funding is not a guarantee and it can take some weeks and months. What are the benefits of participating in Investment Connection? Well, one is training and technical assistance. And we hope that at minimum, that's what you get from the experience. We are here to kind of tell you about the Community Investment Act, how you want to tailor your proposals. What's the language you want to be using in a sense that that identify for a bank or a financial institution why they should think of yourself as a worthy investment or something, at least for a follow-up conversation. We want to be a sounding board. Tell us about your proposal. Let's give you some ideas or suggestions on what we've heard from other institutions or other organizations. We're not here to write your proposal, but we'd love to hear, we want you to use us as a sounding board. A key point of Investment Connection is the preliminary Community Reinvestment Act review. This is a big deal, and I'll get into it in a moment. But the idea is that by submitting your proposal to Investment Connection, our bank examination staff will look at your proposal in advance of a bank or financial institution, and they will make a preliminary review to see whether or not it fits within the parameters of CRA. That's kind of a game changer because normally outside of Investment Connection, The only way our review staff, our bank examination staff review is after a bank has made an investment and during the course of reviewing that bank's performance. So what we're trying to do by doing this preliminary review is to tell banking institutions, look, we as a regulator have looked at this and we think in advance that this meets the general preliminary guidelines of CRA. So we're hoping we're going to remove some of your guesswork and so on. Of course, exposure, visibility, and marketing, and I'll talk about that through our funders portal and our pitch sessions, give you a broader audience than going from one institution to another for your proposal. And then we hope, of course, potential funding. As I said, it's not guaranteed, but also the least opportunity to build partnerships and open up conversations and lines of communication. So we hope those are the benefits that you will derive by considering and putting your proposal into Investment Connection. Okay, I did mention the preliminary review. That is a big attraction to Investment Connection, that we are taking our staff and looking at proposal by proposal before banks even look at them and saying, yeah, we can see how this would qualify potentially for Community Reinvestment Act credit should a bank invest in it. And we can't give a guarantee. We can't sit there and say, stamp it and say, absolutely, this is CRA qualified, because the proposal may change and it depends on what the final deal with the bank and the financial institution, what that actual investment is going to look like. So we can't give a guarantee, but we can at least give guidance to say that it looks like, based on what we're reading in the proposal, that it meets the parameters.
Oh, nice, Rick.
I think we need somebody to go on mute just quickly. Okay. Exposure, again, we're giving you a platform known as the Funders Portal. I'll show that to you in a minute. And that will actually is a searchable database available to banks 365 days a week, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. If they're looking for a CRA potentially eligible proposal, we have a searchable database available to them at any time. And they can search by geography, by type of investment, by type of activity, by locality, and so on. And then there's the pitch session. This is the closest thing we have to Shark Tank, although I think a little bit less of an ego involved. But we actually do these sessions where we pick a select number of proposals from the funders portal to actually do their best pitch in front of a group of funders, and so on. Historically, that's been in person, and I really do like the in person. But obviously, like everything else during the pandemic, that's been virtual, and so on. And so, for this application round, the coming pitch session is scheduled for Monday, October 4th. I believe it's around 10 o'clock. It will be virtual. It will be a select group, and I'll explain why that is. But who will be able to pitch and give their best sales pitch as to why they should have investment. So that's the pitch session. So we think this is a win-win for applicants and funders, even if they don't get funding directly or immediate funding. But it allows them to establish relationships and open the conversation. And we mentioned that community development finance institutions can serve in both capacities. They can both put in an application to receive funding, but they can also be a funder. They can play both sides of the equation, and so on. Oops, sorry. This is what the opening to the Investment Connection Funders Portal looks like. Oh, actually, I'm sorry. This is the application portal. This opened on Monday, July 5th, and it is open to you until the 30th. In fact, the link never goes away, and so on. So when you go to the website, and I'll show our website shortly, you would want, if you've never filled out an application, you need to set up an account. There's no cost to setting up an account, just an email and password. That opens up the application template, and that's on the circumstances under which you would fill out the application, and so on. And somebody pointed out to me that at one point our website, and again, I apologize, still had the application dates from the previous round from March and April. It should now reflect that the application round is from July 5th, Monday, through July 30th. And so that is when we are receiving applications for this round. Application requirements. Okay, let's talk about what we want to see in an application. First of all, we need an overview of your organization and proposed project. You need to tell us who you are and what you're planning to do, and so on. How is the project potentially CRA eligible? So this is where you need to find, to explain to us how it falls in one of those buckets that I talked about. There's a checklist within the application itself, but you also have to describe how it falls under one of these buckets. Then you also need to make the link to how you're serving that LMI population. And there is a box for that. You need to give us census information for the region you're serving or the population you're serving that shows it falls in that low and moderate income range. Or you need to give us information such as if you're working in a particular community with a number of public schools that have a large free and reduced lunch program, that gives us a good indication of the level of income and low and moderate income population. If your program already has built into it certain income limitations, well, you're already there. If you're doing affordable housing, it already has income limitations. But you need to show us that so that we don't have to connect the dots for you. And then we're going to need your most recent financials for your organization, and so on. So, and I'll explain that. So this is what the funders portal looks like. If you go to our website, and again, I'll show this to you shortly, you can actually click on something called View Proposals. It takes you to this screen where we call it the funders portal, but anybody can get access to it. You put out an email and your password, you set up an account, and you will see every proposal we've already submitted and we've already accepted into the funders portal. Again, it's like a menu of ready, funding ready projects that we've already reviewed. And so on. And we've strongly marketed to banks and institutions to use it as their primary first, if they're thinking about what are we going to fund in 2022, we want them to look at the funders portal first to see what's available, and so on. So let's talk about the schedule for this application round. And again, it's primarily focused on rural applications. So the first is you've already accomplished your first goal. You're here today for the training and information session. The application cycle opened July 5th. It is continued to be open until July 30th, close the business. That's where you want to go to the application portal that I showed you and start and filling out your application. During that period of time, as we get applications in and throughout August, and into September, we will review the applications once they're submitted. We'll probably have occasionally reach out to the organizations that submitted them to ask follow-up questions or if we need more information. But we'll do a rolling review. All of this is leading up to a fairly significant event that we at the Richmond Fed have been doing for the last few years. It's called Investing in a Rural America Week. It's a conference that we first did in person in 2019. And then we did it virtually last year. And now we're doing kind of a hybrid where we're going to do some portion of it in person, I believe in North Carolina. We'll let you know about that over the week of October 4th through the 8th. And some of it will be virtual. During the first day of that week is when our virtual pitch session will happen, Monday, October 4th. So some of the applications that will get into the funders portal, at least one from each of our states, will be selected to be part of, to make their pitch in front of a virtual audience of bankers and funders and so on. And again, we will provide this follow-up dates as well. But the first thing we want you to focus on right now is that the application round is portal is open, and it's open from July 5th to July 30th and so on. So let me cover some basic guidelines and best practices, and then I'll turn to your questions. And so on. So what is rural? Because again, our objective here for this round is to try to put a highlight on rural projects and proposals in line with the Rural America Week we're going to be showcasing in October. Well, you know, we wanted a definition for rural, and then we found out that everybody has a different definition for rural, and they can get fairly complicated. The Office of Management and Budget has one, U.S. Department of Agriculture has another, National Center for Health Statistics has yet another, and then the Census Bureau from 2010 and probably in 2020 yet has another definition of rural. And often state agencies and localities may have a different definition of rural. A lot of them, their definition is basically first to define what is urban, and they'll define it by density in terms of density in a census tract of anywhere from 2,500 households to clusters of 50,000. And then basically once they define urban, they turn around and say, well, if you're not in those in that definition of urban, then we're gonna consider you effectively rural. That's just too complicated, we think. And the thing is that we believe that if you are already on interested in investment connection and you've responded to our appeal through organizations like the Rural Maryland Council and other organizations in other states, you have a best definition of what you define as rural. So let's make this simple. First and foremost in your application, of course, you need to tell us how you're serving low and moderate income individuals. That's what gets you qualified under the auspices of the Community Investment Act. But then we're going to ask you to tell us why you believe you are serving primarily a rural population in your application, in your proposal, how you define it. We want a broad, expansive, inclusive approach to this. Mind you, if some reason you fall short of explaining to us why you are serving a rural population, if you generally still meet the parameters of the Community Reinvestment Act, we still are likely to put you in the funders portal, because the bottom line is any proposal that serves low and moderate income communities is still one that we feel we want to showcase. We've just added this extra layer, this additional layer for this particular round, because we wanted to highlight rural proposals in this round. And so we want you to tell us why you're rural. Even if that means you're close to a metropolitan district or close to an urban district, but you feel like you're right on the line, we do want you, however, to make sure your application and project does, in fact, focus primarily on how you define a rural population. It doesn't, by the way, if your organization does serve a variety of different populations, that's fine in overall, but we do want your proposal that you're submitting to us to be primarily focused on a rural population. I've given you two pictures of the boxes in the application where you can tell us a little bit about why you serve a rural community, not a little bit, but explain to us. Population served is one box, and then population income area median income is the other area where, one, you need to tell us how you're serving primarily an LMI, low and moderate income population, but you also need to tell us in a sentence or two, at least, how you're serving a rural population. And again, we can talk about that further. So let's just go back and review the primary purpose fall under the auspices of the Community Reinvestment Act is that your initiative has to benefit low and moderate income communities or small businesses. It doesn't have to be the exclusive population, but it has to be the primary purpose. You need to be able to document or measure and make it quantifiable through census tracts or school data, unless your program already has income limitations built into it. One thing we do not want to see or prefer not to see is zip codes. Zip codes are too broad. Census tracts are better. Zip codes are just too broad. We also need an audited or reviewed financial statement, which you will upload on your application through a PDF. So an audit or review financial statement, usually something put together by a CPA or some other type of review firm or organization. It could be some other type of nonprofit review that essentially just does a financial audit or review independent of your organization. We need it to be within the last 2 years of your application. So something back to 2017 is not going to work for us, and so on. We do not accept 990s as a review, as a financial review. That's a statement you file with the IRS to tell them you're a nonprofit. That doesn't really tell us that what your fiscal stability is. Also, budget documents is not the same. I will talk to you about where we would like to see a budget, if possible, but that's not in lieu of getting some type of audited financial statement. Now, look, I know a lot of your organizations are relatively new. Maybe you haven't been in existence for more than 2 years. I also know that during the pandemic, a lot of organizations had to shift priorities, and it just wasn't easy to get an audited financial statement. They're not cheap. I understand that. So we've tried to come up with some exceptions. One is, if you're asking for like a small grant request or even a small loan of less than 5% of your organization's assets, we may be able to accept that in lieu, waive the financial review statement or the audited statement. I mean, if it's a relatively small financial request, I mean, we're willing on a case-by-case basis. You would want to get in contact with us so that we can understand why that is. Also, if your organization is already under some type of fiscal sponsorship by an organization who's essentially doing your financial review, they are essentially vouching for you from a financial reason. They're either maintaining your books, paying your bills for you because you're a new organization under a fiscal sponsorship. We'll accept that if that organization will send a letter or someone saying that you're in that relationship. Also, if you're an agency that receives a large portion of your funding for this particular program or project from a government agency or grantee who has already reviewed you and accepted you into the program, such as a housing agency providing you subsidy, low-income housing tax credits, or so on, we may also accept a letter from them in lieu of a financial statement. But those are going to be on a case-by-case basis. Otherwise, we really do need to have that audited or reviewed financial statement. That's just to make sure that we've done our due diligence to make sure you are who you claim to be, and then you're in relatively good fiscal health, and so on. So I'm going to wrap it up. Some tips and ideas. First of all, people always ask us, well, what is the minimum or maximum dollar amount I can ask for? Well, we don't have one. Whatever is necessary to fund your project or your initiative, that's what you should put in there. But keep in mind, I mean, if the more money you ask for, whether it be in a grant or a loan, if you're talking about millions of dollars or even multiple six-figure requests, you know, it's not likely that any one bank or foundation is going to be able to completely fund the project. So keep that in mind. It might be best to list, okay, here's the overall amount we need, and there's a box for you to do that. But we're willing to accept smaller increment financing from different institutions. A bank's got to think to themselves, you're asking for $25 million to build a rec center. I don't have a $25 million budget for community development. So I don't know where I fit in, but if you can give me an idea that you will accept smaller amounts, then yeah, I can see where I can fit into that equation. You also want to provide some information that you're not asking for a single donor to give you the entire funding. Are you getting government grants? Are you getting tax credits? Is there some matching fund? What's the overall context by which you're receiving funding? So if you're asking for $25 million to build a rec center, are you expecting a single bank to provide the funding? Not going to happen. Very few foundations or banks are going to do that. I'm sure there are some out there, but they're not many. So you need to kind of convey in your application, what's the broader effort? And where are you expecting to get all of your funding from, in addition to requesting it from banks, institutions, foundations, and so on. These are just tips and suggestions to make your application a little bit more understandable or attractive to an institution. This is a pet peeve of mine. When you're writing the title to your proposal, don't give me a paragraph, make it succinct. Cherry Hill Town Center Renovation Project. Don't do what the red here does, where they give me an entire sentence for a title. It just seems really kind of a waste of character space. And you really want to get to the point. And also try not to put in the name of your proposal, your name of your organization in the proposal title. You're already listing that somewhere else, and so on. So just a pet peeve of mine, it's your title, do it as you wish. Again, I would ask you to think about doing a quick Excel spreadsheet, turn it into a PDF. There's a place in the application, you're not required to do this, where you can upload a PDF under where it says pictures, video, additional documentation. You can do that. It's just a nice way of giving a fuller picture as to how are you planning to spend the money and how is it going to be worked? How is it going to be organized? Just a suggestion, not a requirement. bottom line, proposal description, the most important part of your application, get to the point, who, what, where, of what you're planning to do. You have a limited number of characters, 2,500 max in that box, and spaces count. So focus on the proposal. Don't get too much into the history of your organization or your past accomplishments. That's what your website's for. You will have a point in your application to put in your web address so they can look at your website. Don't use your limited character space and to give me the origin story of your organization. This is not a Marvel movie. So don't get to the heart of the organization and what you're trying to, what your project and what you're trying to do. Also, I know you want to explain a little bit about what the need is, whether it be affordable housing or food distribution or workforce development. Of course you want to talk about it, but don't give me a whole sociological a paper on the needs of your community. Explain the needs succinctly and how you're planning to address that and how what you're planning to accomplish. Remember that a lot of the banks, institutions that are going to review it are aware of a lot of these needs. And they don't have to be convinced that there's a need. They need to be convinced why their investment is going to address that and so on. This is by and far my largest pet peeve. Get to the point of how you plan to use the money. I can't tell you how many organizations go into the whole explanation. They ask for $500,000 and they never get around to actually selling me in even one sentence how they plan to spend the money in the proposal. So please include a sentence that says how you actually plan to use the money. Not just the overall need that the money might address. And that's where a budget could be helpful, but that's a suggestion. So, you know, I'm going to use the money to enroll 60 participants. I'm hiring an employment specialist or a marketing specialist, or we're buying supplies, or it's going to expand the program to a certain number of applicants. I can't tell you how many proposals don't do that. And so if I'm a funder, I'm like, well, what is my actual money going to be used for? Let's finally review. We need an overview of your organization and proposed project. You need to tell us how you are potentially serving in a CRA activity. You know, what are you doing in terms of one of those activities? You need to connect the dots on how you're primarily serving a low and moderate income community through various types of data or census tract information. And then you need to give us your financials. And so on. That's what's considered a complete application. Finally, this is the general investment connection email address, but then I'm giving you the three different community development managers for each of the regions. I'm Maryland and Greater Washington, DC. My colleague Tiffany Holland Wright covers Virginia and West Virginia, and Erica Bell covers North and South Carolina. We will provide this PowerPoint to you, so you can get it, but it's also on our website and so on. And so on. So I know I've thrown a lot at you and so on. So let's move to questions. And then I can also walk you through kind of the websites if you'd like to. So I've stopped sharing my screen and I do
Hi,
see-
Peter, this yes. is Pam. I have- four questions, Peter, that you haven't answered. Many of them you've answered verbally. So I'll okay. read the first one that wasn't answered. It was from Jerry McLaurin. CDFI has strict guidelines. How can we customize grants and loans when it comes to African American community?
Great question. And you've hit, so no, CDFI is already pre-approved by the Federal Reserve, by the IRS. As a community development finance institution. Pretty much any CDFI activity is almost certainly gonna fall under the Community Reinvestment Act. If it's an investment into a CDFI or it's an investment by a CDFI, it really doesn't take a lot of effort to convince us it's a Community Reinvestment Act eligible activity. That's the very purpose of a CDFI. But you brought up the issue of a particular African-American community. Now, here's the reality. I know, and I think a lot of us know, that when redlining was done in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, and so on, it was predominantly a race and ethnic based practice. And we're living in that legacy. But the Community Reinvestment Act, when written in 1977, is not specific to race. It is a factor, but it is not a predominant factor. The Community Reinvestment Act is based on income, independent of race, and so on. There is a lot of conversation about modernizing this Community Reinvestment Act, and there's a lot of talk within the activist community and the advocacy community about further tailoring programs to specifically address racial disparity. But based on the way the act is currently enacted and regulations, race is not a specific factor. So to answer your question, I certainly mention that you are serving a particular population, but I think you still need to emphasize that what you're serving is a low and moderate income population. And so on. Last round of Investment Connection, we had a specific CDFI that is primarily there to assist African-American owned farms and farmers. And I mean, I don't need convincing that that particular demographic and sector needs assistance, not just based on their income, but also the historic legacy of discrimination. But the reality is that they needed to emphasize, and they did, that what they were serving was the income level of that population primarily, and not so much the race. So I hope that answers your question. It's often a controversial topic. Pam, another question?
Yes, it's from Laura. Can you use an audit instead of audited financial statements?
Well, I mean, if it's an audit that has shown that you're in good fiscal health and that you are who you claim to be, and it's in the last 2 years, yes, we'll look at it. We'll take a look at it. I mean, an audited financial statement is a particular CPA term of art, I believe, or reviewed. But yeah, go ahead and submit it. We'll look at it, and you know, if it meets our, you know, we'll let you know, and we'll be back in touch with you regardless.
Okay, the next one's from Genevieve. Who specifically should we contact if we don't have an audit?
Reviewed financial statement. Well, you can contact me. In the short term, Peter Dolkart, and again, you've got my email because I've sent it to you, and so on, and we can talk over the next days and weeks, and we can look at what possible solutions. Again, we try to provide exceptions. If there's 5% of over total assets you're requesting, we might be able to find, and you know, that might work. If you've got a fiscal sponsor, that might work. If you have a government agency that's providing you affordable housing tax credits for a project or something else, we'll talk. We're not looking for reasons to exclude people from Investment Connection, but we do have to maintain a certain matter of due diligence. I'll be very upfront though. Investment Connection, as much as I wish it was the case, is not well-suited to startup organizations. They do tend to have a little bit of a couple of years of fiscal track record, but we're trying to find ways to accommodate. Next question.
Actually, Erica answered the last question in the chat. Everyone has said that this is outstanding, and they have asked for the recording and the presentation to be sent to them, which I shared that you would.
Excellent. Any other questions on the chat?
Another question just came through from Dwayne. Where are most of the funders using the portal located?
Well, I mean, we're now across the districts. So, you know, across from South Carolina all the way up to Maryland, DC, West Virginia, Virginia, and so on. So depending on which round we're doing, we focused on the banking sector of that region. I'll be very candid with you again about Maryland. It's you know, Maryland, unfortunately, historically has been a very Baltimore-centric place. And a lot of our banking institutions tend to be headquartered in Baltimore. So when I do rounds in Maryland, I tend to have a large distribution of Baltimore area or headquartered banks. One of the reasons we're doing the rural initiative in this round is to try to change that and to open up the market to other proposals and projects. But unfortunately, metropolitan areas traditionally do tend to be where banks and financial institutions are concentrated. Hopefully the people in this webinar can help us change that trend. What banks often tell us, by the way, regardless of where they're headquartered, is, can you find us more projects in rural areas? There's plenty of projects in urban areas, and they need assistance. We'd like to diversify our our portfolio. We need to serve, we have what we call an assessment area on the Eastern Shore of Maryland or on this part of North Carolina, and we need more projects. So that's where we're looking to you to help us help them. Next question.
From Maria, are there any projects that you are aware of that have any emphasis on education?
In terms of our previous, yes, we've had projects that dealt with financial empowerment and financial education. I encourage you to look at the funders portal. And by the way, look at the funders portal as a good guide just to see what people have used for their proposals in the past. I'm not saying you should copy or plagiarize, but it's a good guide. But yes, we've had financial education and financial empowerment programs in the past, if that's what you're referring to. I would love to get, for example, from say United Way or something, they have what's known as VITA, the tax assistance organizations that help people do earned income tax credit. Those would be great proposals to get. I'm not suggesting that you have to submit, but that's a wonderful process. And that seems very worthy of Community Investment Act eligible activity.
The next question from Jerry. Peter, can we schedule a presentation to our African-American nonprofits and businesses in Prince George's County?
Absolutely. Just give me a date. We'll do it. I said this when we started Investment Connection 2 years ago, when we were still allowed to travel. I'll go anywhere and talk to anyone about this program. Virtually allows us to do that without me ever having to leave my office or my living room or worry about what I'm wearing. So yeah, absolutely. We'll talk to, if you know, as long as I have the time on the calendar, we'll talk.
And that is all the questions for now, Peter.
Okay. Well, if you have other questions, please, you know, put them in the chat. Let me see if I can just share with you, open up the funders portal for you to look at directly, and so on. And I may run the risk of actually sharing my email or some other aspects of my screen, but okay. Hopefully you should be able to see my screen shortly. Sorry, I'm just opening up the internet. Okay. Hopefully you can see the Google screen. I'm not trying to be an advertisement for Google, but if you can't, just let me know. But so first thing you wanna do, if you're looking for the Investment Connection webpage, if you haven't found it, really quick thing to do is just do Investment Connection, but make sure you do Richmond Fed, because several other Federal Reserve banks have an Investment Connection program. So Kansas City, St. Louis. So make sure you are on the Richmond Fed Investment Connection screen. Okay, hopefully you're all seeing my screen. So first thing off, this is the Investment Connection page for the Richmond Fed. As you can see, we're already referring to the application round and so on. But here's where view proposals. These are proposals that were already submitted over previous rounds. You click on view proposals. Now, I've already signed in, so I don't have the login screen because I'm already signed in. You will get a login screen and you need to fill out and create a username and password. Again, it's called the Funders Portal. It's not exclusive to funders. Anybody can get access to the Funders Portal. Once you're in the Funders Portal, you'll need to do a profile called interest profile. One, the thing you need to do is select the states you want to look at, because theoretically on the funders portal, you can look at any investment connection proposal submitted to any Federal Reserve Bank across the United States. But let's face it, we only care about Maryland, West Virginia, North and South Carolina, District of Columbia, and so on. The other states can fend for themselves. I didn't officially say that. So you want to make sure you set it to show that you're seeing the right territories. Then you can also limit it to the activity or type of proposal. But as you can see, it presents this menu of organization name and proposal title and where it's located. This is why I emphasize keep your title short and to the point. You start writing paragraphs in your title, the eye scanning through this is going to lose that. Keep it to the point. Cherry Hill, town, center, renovation project. We know what they're doing. An organization can then select and actually see the proposal. It has all the contact information, the proposal title, how much money they're asking for, the project description, what type of relief they're looking at, what type of issues they're addressing, the population served. Here they're making the case that 77% of who are classified are low and moderate income based on poverty. Again, they're connecting the dots for us. You know, one of the things I've run into in the past is organizations, let's use Baltimore as an example, who will say, well, I'm in Sandtown, Winchester. Of course, I'm serving a low and moderate income population. Now, if you live in Baltimore, you know that Sandtown, Winchester is a community that is very underserved and disinvested. But the people reading these applications, the banks, the funders, they don't know that name. They don't know what that means. So you've got to lay it out for them. You can't just make assumptions. There is a description of the evaluation process, and then they can actually download or print out the application, the proposal, that is. One thing, by the way, you don't see in here is we ask you for a financial statement for us to review. We do not put your financial statement out on the funders portal. That's for our own due diligence, okay? So that's just to make sure that we're covering it. So that's the funders portal.
So Greg left.
Yeah,
he must be telling us.
That's what I figured.
I'm sorry, I think somebody needs to go on mute, Mr. Browning. Thank you. I feel like a school proctor. I'm sorry about that. Then there's also the application portal. The application portal is, again, you submit applications. You go down here and you hit login to create an application. Again, I've already logged in, so I already have this screen up, and these are all these kind of test proposals I've set up. Here's what the inside of the application portal looks like. Once you've set up an application, you open it if you've already started one, and here's your format. Name of organization, mission statement, your overview. Now notice there are limitations of how many characters. So you have to be too succinct and to the point. 2,500 characters, spaces included. Website, your primary contact information, your secondary contact information. Folks, make sure this is right. In a year's time, a bank may call you and they want to have a follow-up conversation. If you don't have the right number or something's wrong, they don't know how to reach you. It's a wrong number. I recognize people change, organizations come and go. We can talk about that at another time about how you can update your application. Here's where you click what type of support you're requesting. As soon as you click on one of these, the dollar box pops up. Okay, how much money you're asking for. You want to tell us what, if any, other partners are in your proposal. Who's else on board? It's okay if you don't have other partners. It's best if you do. It's okay if you don't. Here's where you click. Here's the most important box of all, proposal description. Here's where you tell us you want to click on which activity. If some of the activity you feel you're funding doesn't fall in this box, there's another box. Tell us what the other is. Geographic, you want to make sure you click on the state that you're covering. You can click on more than one state if you're covering more than one state. Population served, and telling us where you're serving low and moderate income. In one of these boxes, you do need to tell us how you're serving a rural population based on your definition. You also need to tell us how you measure success. How do you know that this program is going to succeed? What do you consider to be a measure of success? Is an existing or new program? Here's where you upload your PDF audited or reviewed financial statement. You can also upload a picture or video if you want, or other additional things. You can also upload your budget document in this as well, in one of these boxes. Not required. Audited financial statement, reviewed financial, required. Unless you've worked something out with us, these two boxes not required. Here's the last word. Anything else you want to say? When you're ready, hit mark complete. submitted. Okay. Okay, I know, well, we're right at 12 noon, and I know I've talked and talked and talked. Any last questions or anything that anyone's put in the chat box? One last thing, I feel like I missed something. We're only gonna select 5 proposals for the pitch session. There's gonna be more proposals, we think, that are gonna be in the funders portal that are gonna be added to the funders portal than can pitch. Do not consider, if you're not picked for the pitch session, that something is wrong with your proposal. We have to just pick one from each state, and we want a diversity of activity, okay? So I will say to the Maryland and DC metropolitan area, you submit an application and it gets into the funders portal, I will find an opportunity in 2022 to do some type of process where we can showcase your proposal in a future pitch session. I can't guarantee it, but that's my goal, is that we will hopefully go back on the road in person, and I will come to Salisbury and Easton and Hagerstown and you know, parts of Southern Maryland. And I will go to Northern Virginia or parts of DC, working with my colleagues, and we will find a way for you to have a little more visibility. And Chestertown, yes, okay, and Chestertown. That's Maryland. I work, my two other colleagues who work the other, who manage the other, will also find what's the right formula for their region as well. So I'm sorry that not everybody gets to pitch, but we will include you in the funders portal, and we're always trying to find ways to be creative, to constantly showcase through maybe videos, small little videos, or other things that we can figure out. So don't be discouraged if you don't get asked to pitch. I definitely encourage you to get your application in early. That gives us more lead time, and so on.
Peter, there are a couple other questions, but we are out of time. I have saved the chat, so it's up to you whether, and the people attending, if you want me to read the questions or if you want to just answer them after the meeting, because I did save the chat, so you will have who asked each question.
Well, I'm willing to say a few more minutes, I mean, to answer a few more questions, but you're not obligated. People are not.
I'll read the next one then. From Crystal, the round has a rural focus. What have been the focal of the past rounds? Do you know the focus for the future rounds?
Sure, great question. Well, I will say in the immediate aftermath, we were already planning to do rounds in February, March, of last year. We were planning to do them prior to the pandemic. Once the pandemic hit, we made a priority of pandemic-related proposals. Not exclusive, but pandemic, but certainly that was a priority. We also moved, we were expanding into new regions and states in prior rounds that we hadn't previously done. At this point, I think we're in every region now. So we also were exclusively focusing on portions of Virginia, North Carolina versus South Carolina, and so on. So some of it was just geographic. I did a specific round on broadband and digital equity for a round in last year, looking at applications or projects. That was mostly, I would say, Baltimore-based, but not exclusively, on terms of getting computer equipment, getting access, getting broadband access, getting assistance to families that did not have broadband access, and therefore were obviously under disadvantage for everything from employment and benefits to education and their child attending school. So those have been previous focuses. We've even done some interesting work. My colleague Tiffany did a wonderful round where we teamed up with the Appalachian Opportunity Fund that was dealing with we're focused on the Opportunity Zone applications in West Virginia and Appalachia, and we found some really great synergies there, and so on. So, you know, it's either based on geography or it's based on a particular need or sector. This is unique because we're doing rural, and we're doing it across the entire district.
Okay, Peter, the next one from Jamie. Are these submissions that have received funding or all submitted?
You mean in the funders portal? Yeah, well, they've all been reviewed and they've all been entered into the funders portal, and they're all eligible for a bank to give them funding. And we've had kind of a mixed record in terms of, like, in the Appalachian case I just mentioned, we did have at least one or two organizations who were already receiving opportunity funding also get the benefit of investment connection. I've had other in my region receive support for computer equipment, for refurbishment, technical assistance and funding. We've also, I think, at Habitat in one also received funding. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. The vast majority of the projects we've had in Funders Portal are still waiting for further funding and assistance. It takes time, but they're all eligible. And that's what gets them in the Funders Portal, is that we reviewed them and they met our criteria.
And so, next question from Genevieve. If you're requesting general operating support, can you ask for that? Can you include other props that generally partner with you?
Yes, to the latter question, you can. I've had proposals that represented multiple organizations working together, particularly under COVID relief, where it was an entire coalition of organizations. One organization took the lead on submitting the application, but they made it clear that they were part of a broader coalition. In fact, the Digital Equity Coalition was multiple organizations working together. Operating support, yeah, you know, yes, we don't have a limitation on that. You know, I would generally, just as this is Peter Dolkart speaking, prefer that organizations don't request funding simply to keep their lights on, because the question is, are they sustainable if they didn't get that funding? But that's just my own, that's still an eligible, I mean, still not excluded for investment connection. In other words, so I'd rather it was funding to expand or grow service to low and moderate income households, to provide a more level of service, to provide broader coverage of service and so on, rather than just paying staff to keep staff working. But I recognize COVID's put its test to everything. So I'm open to it all. I'm open to it all. So.
And it looks like the last question is from Jennifer. Once a proposal is reviewed, can organizations pitch their proposals to banks outside of the investment connection process?
Absolutely. But the fact is, they can do that without investment connection. I mean, they didn't need us to do that, and so on. So of course you can. And you feel free to download or print or use the funders portal for reference when you go and talk to that bank. That's what it's there for. But of course, I mean, the whole argument is, without investment connection, you were free to walk into any financial institution, bank, philanthropy, and ask for money anyway. You don't need us. We simply are trying to make it easier for you and give you a little bit of a head start by saying, oh, but by the way, one of the financial regulators looked at this and they've made a predetermination or preliminary review, is the word I want to use, that it seems to meet CRA eligibility. Which is what you wouldn't have been able to do without investment connection. But of course, it's a free country and you're free to talk to any bank or institution as you wish without us. We're just trying to make it easier.
And Peter, we did get one other question in from John. It says that considering the advancement in food production technology, what focus is given to the urban environment?
I'm not sure I fully understand.
Maybe it's from John Spearman, but he does have at the top John Oasis Farms LLC. It's the very last question. So maybe he was pointing that towards him. I'm not sure.
Yeah, well, I mean, and John, feel free to reach out to me, but I guess what I would say is, if you're talking like something like urban farming, the focus of this round is predominantly rural, but we're not excluding any CRA, any proposals submitted to us, because it doesn't meet the rural. It just means that, you know, we're going to pick rural proposals to pitch in October. But if you generally meet the, you know, the guidelines of the program, even if it's an urban-based program, you know, we're not going to sit there. As far as my geography in Maryland and Greater Washington, I'm not going to throw you out because it's not a rural-based proposal. But that's what our focus is on this time. So I hope that answers your questions, but feel free to reach out to me and we can chat further.
And that's it, Peter.
Okay, folks, I know I talked and talked and talked. I really do appreciate it. I appreciate also the fact that we overlooked our earlier glitch. I am available throughout this month, as my colleagues are, to talk to you further. We hope you do submit your application sooner than later, so that we have a chance to review it and ask questions. And we thank you for your interest, and so on. So thank you, everyone. Have a pleasant rest of the day. And by the way, enjoy freezer pop day, which apparently it is National Popsicle Day. So please indulge. Take care.